Attendees are in listen-only mode.
Welcome to today's webinar, Fake It Till You Become It, How to Be the Calm, Assertive Leader Your Stakeholders Require, co-sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association and Alumni Career Services. My name is Kara Tyrone, Associate Director of ACS, and our presenter today is Larry Stybel, co-founder of Stybel Peabody and accomplished author. Before we start, I have just a few reminders for the audience. Questions are welcome throughout today's webinar. Simply type them in the question area as you have them in real time. I will hold on to all questions until the speaker has finished the presentation. We will begin the Q&A session during the last 20 minutes of the call. Remember that no question is silly and every question is worth asking. Now is your chance to hear from an expert in the field. Please note that this presentation will be recorded and made available to all registrants within 3 days on our YouTube channel. And finally, if you are having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the chat area. Without further ado, I'd like to go ahead and introduce our presenter. Larry Stybel is a national thought leader in corporate governance, leadership, and senior executive careers. As a thought leader, he is co-author of Navigating the Waterfall, a guide to managing your professional life during turbulent times. He and Marianne Peabody are co-founders of BoardOptions.com and Stybel Peabody, an Arbora global company. Core services revolve around retained search, leadership development, and executive outplacement. There are 500 consultants in 25 U.S. cities and 30 countries. Larry is a licensed psychologist with a doctorate from Harvard University. His monthly perspectives about leadership appear in Psychology Today as Platform for Success, The Making of Great Leaders. Larry, we're so excited to have you join us today, and now I will go ahead and turn it over to you.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate it, and welcome to everybody. I look forward to talking about faking it until you become it, calm, assertive leadership. The mission is to sort of understand some of the biological forces behind calm, assertive leadership and how to use your body to stimulate critical hormones associated with calm, assertive leadership. Then we're going to be talking about key words and key phrases that you can use to create the impression of calm, assertive leadership. The general theme of what we're talking about today is fake it until you become it. Leadership is a performance art. And in the beginning, you'll be faking it. But as you continue to do it, you will become it. And that's the basic theme here. I'd like to start off by asking you to take out a piece of paper and grab a pen or pencil. And I'd like you to write the name of a leader who most inspired you. This could be someone from a work situation. It could be from a family situation. It could be a character in a book that you read, or it could be a historical character. Just write down the name, and this is just for you. We're not going to share it with others, but write down the name. I'll give you 3 more seconds to do that. Okay. A key issue in this conversation is that your stakeholders, your customers, the people on your team, the potential people who might hire you are desperate. And what they're looking for is calm, assertive leaders. Now, where this comes from is actually a program that some of you may have actually watched. Cesar Millan's show, The Dog Whisperers, I don't think it's on anymore, but it was on the National Geographic calendar. And Cesar Millan is a Mexican-American in Los Angeles, and he trains dogs. And the show was about owners bringing their dogs in for, quote-unquote, help. The interesting thing about the show, however, is that while Cesar Millan calls himself a dog trainer, that's really not what he does. He's a people trainer. The dogs were usually fine. It was the owners that were having a problem. And what Cesar Millan was saying is that dogs are pack animals, and they want their leaders to be calm, yet assertive. And if they are calm without being assertive, then the dog sees a power vacuum and says, I gotta fill it. If, on the other hand, you're assertive without being calm, you're just freaking the dog out. And so much of the show was about how do you help owners to become the calm, assertive pet owners that the dog wants. And my point is, I think we're a lot like dogs. Maybe not as good as dogs, but we're a lot like dogs. And there's an article in the Journal of Business Psychology in 2010. It was called Leadership Equal Communication? And it was they looked at 279 employees in one organization, and they really wanted to find out which leaders get the best and most productive employees. And they looked at team leaders who were charismatic versus very task-oriented leaders versus people who were none of those but very people-oriented leaders. And they wanted to see which style is the best. And again, just like the Cesar Millan show, what they found was that people produced more when their leader was both calm and assertive. And in the context of the studies, I mean, they perceive their leader as being supportive, therefore calm, but also precise about what he or she wanted and precise about providing feedback. That kind of calmness and precision was most linked to outcome and also perceived satisfaction. Just like Cesar Millan said, calm and assertive leader. Here's an example of a great calm and assertive leader. Here's another example of a fabulous calm and assertive leader. And if any of you saw the wonderful movie Lincoln, I think the actor who won the Academy Award for that just totally nailed Lincoln. And what you do see is a kind of a calm person when all around him there was chaos. And he had an objective and he kept focusing on that objective, but doing it in a very calm way. Again, this is very interesting for those who know Abraham Lincoln's story, in that he was a pretty depressed individual, and several times during his life, people were afraid he was going to commit suicide. But when he was president, he faked it, and he faked it until he became it. He was the calm, assertive leader. This is another very typical example of people who have gone into surgery. You want your surgeon to be calm and assertive. Typically, a surgeon is going to give you the following statement. I'm sorry you have to go through this procedure, but I've gone through hundreds of these procedures. Based on my experience and also the literature, I think there's an 80% chance this will turn out to be successful. And when the person says that in a calm way, you relax, which is why the surgeon is saying exactly what he just said. Now, the other kind of leader that that you could be is assertive, but not calm. Anyone come to mind? Of course, there he is. Very, very entertaining individual. I can understand why he had high ratings. The question is going to become, when you think about him having the access to the nuclear codes. I'm not making a political statement. All I'm saying, we're talking about personality. This is the kind of person, according to Cesar Millan, will just freak most people out as a leader. On the other hand, there is the calm but not assertive person, and you don't want to be known as that. Your subordinates will see that you're not promotable, that you're not powerful, and they will try to go around you. So, here's a little exercise that I would like you to do. So here's a scale. And on the zero side is someone who's calm but not assertive. On the 10 side, we've got somebody who's very assertive but not calm. So on a scale of 0 to 10, what I'd like you to do is take that sheet of paper I ask you to have and give yourself a number. How would you evaluate yourself today on a 0 to 10 scale? Why don't you do that now? Give yourself a number. Okay, now, give yourself a number. What do you think your key stakeholders need you to be? Put a number there. And so the gap between where you see yourself today and where you think your key stakeholders need you to be is what we're going to be focusing on. Our goal in this session, if we can improve your performance by 10%, we'll be doing a lot. The first thing we're going to be discussing is scripting of calm, assertive leadership, the linguistics. Again, management is a performing art, and much of the art is in the process of the words that are selected. Words are important, and words become scripts. I think many of you have flown airlines, and you've flown airlines enough to know when you get into the plane, the flight attendants are going to be basically reciting a script to you about plane safety. And you may not even listen to them anymore, but you know what's going to come next. And the nice thing about scripts is it's predictable. And for those of you who are managing organizations, it's leverageable. Once you've created the script, you can ask everyone to use the same script. This is a typical example in a hospital. Patient is there, a nurse or orderly or physician comes, looks at your chart, and despite looking at the chart, comes to you and says, "Would you tell me your name and date of birth?" And again, what they're doing is double checking to make sure you are the person on the chart. Once the script is done, nobody has to think about it anymore. You anticipate that it's coming, and it's easy for the employees and it's easy for the patient. But it does create a sense of consistency and continuity, and it's easily leveraged. So again, I'm a big believer in scripting. It's predictable, it's impersonal, it's an expression of corporate values, and it's great for leverageability. Now, what are you going to say? Here's a little story. The man on the right is President Dwight D. Eisenhower. The man on the left is John Foster Dulles, Secretary of State for Dwight Eisenhower. They were talking about invading a country, not Cuba, but it was some country in South America that had elected a communist as president. And what they were going to do is to topple that president. I think it could have been Peru, but I'm not sure. Eisenhower turns to Dulles and says, "If we fail to invade this country, what's the probability that our interests will be hurt?" And John Foster Dulles said, 100%. And then Eisenhower turns to Dulles and says, "And if we do invade the country, what's the probability that we'll be successful?" And John Foster Dulles says, 60%. Eisenhower then smiles and says, "Then go ahead and invade." And then he says something very interesting. He said, "John, if you had said 100% chance of success, I wouldn't have done it." Interesting. "John, if you'd said 100% chance of success, I wouldn't have done it." Partially, this explains a man like Eisenhower. He was general of the army during World War II. He commanded D-Day. So he's used to dealing with low probability of events, and he's comfortable with it. But also, it also expresses something else. His mistrust of anyone who'd said there's 100% chance of success. Think about your own experience. If I was selling you investment products and I said 100% guarantee you're going to get 12% return on your investment, would you write a check to me or would you hug your wallet closer? I think there are certain words that people get guarded with. And one of the things that I have found, and one of the things I recommend to my clients, is that they start speaking like a weatherman and talk about forecasts. Most people are comfortable in the 70 to 80% range. If you go too low, like 40%, people are going to say it's too risky. If, on the other hand, you go 100% or 90% or 95%, people are going to say, I don't trust you. Which is why the surgeon in my example before said, based on my experience and the research, there's an 80% chance this surgery would be successful. That is sort of a code that gets you calm. So think about something and then give a percentage of success to it, keeping in mind that the 70 to 80-ish range is something that people are comfortable with. Don't go over 85 and try not to go under it. For those of you in the job search, the question may be, can you do what this job requires? A great answer to be calm and assertive is to say, I can't say 100% because there's so much about this company and this job and the people that I don't know. But based on my past experience, I can say I'm at the 70 to 85% comfort level that I can do what this job requires. That will get the other person calm and comfortable. So what I'd like you to do, take out a sheet of paper and write down something that you could do starting Monday next week, where you could say something to someone that would get them calm using a probability statement. Take out a sheet of paper, write something that you could do starting Monday next week, where you'd be saying something to somebody to help calm them down using a probability statement like what we just discussed. Go ahead, write it down. I'll wait for you. Okay. I'll give you about 10 more seconds. Think about next week. Okay, that looks good. Another really powerful linguistic tool that you can do to be the calm, assertive leadership is to paraphrase. This is something that I find young executives seldom do, and it is so important. We all have a desperate need to feel people are listening to us. And the reality is, in our business and often in our personal lives, people are really not listening to us. They're just going through the motions and pretending they're listening to us. They're just waiting for their turn to speak. Paraphrasing is a wonderful, powerful technique that basically says to the other person, I am listening to you. And the way to paraphrase is the following. Let me put in my own words what I just heard you say. And then you basically repeat what you just heard using your own words. Sometimes, it'll be rare, but sometimes somebody will say, well, that's not really what I meant. More often, they're going to say, that's right. That's exactly what I'm looking at. And again, I think paraphrasing is an extraordinarily useful, powerful tool to create the calm, assertive presence that people really need you to be. So you might want to write this down, paraphrase. The words is I'll summarize what I just heard you say in my own words to make sure I get it. I'll summarize what I just heard you say in my own words to make sure I get it. And then you do. again, you want to paraphrase because maybe you didn't get it. Maybe you misunderstood. So this allows you to be corrected. But the more important reason is you probably will understand what the person said. This shows you are not the kind of person whose idea of silence is politely waiting your turn to talk. Being known as an active listener puts you in a very powerful role because most people are not good listeners. So, what I'd like you to do is take out a piece of paper. Think about your professional life next week. Write something down, an incident that you anticipate will come up next week, where you could do something that would involve paraphrasing. Again, think about your life next week. Think about some incident that will come up next week. Write something down where you might be able to paraphrase. And again, the paraphrase is, let me summarize what I just heard you say in my own words to make sure I understand what you mean. I'll give you 5 more seconds. Remember, you're thinking about next week, something you can do next week that might involve paraphrasing. Okay, you have been sitting for too long. Come on, stand up. Yes, yes, you. I see you. Stand up and stretch. Come on, you need to stretch. That's it. Good, 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 good. All right, sit down. Sit down. You're having too much fun. Good. Now, the next part, we first talked about psycholinguistics, words that you can use to get people to feel that you are calm and assertive. Now we're going to be talking about neurochemistry. There is a hormone in the body called testosterone, and we all have it. Yes, even women have it. And when testosterone is in your body, you feel a sense of confidence. Of course, you have heightened sexual arousal. But testosterone in the body is good. The second hormone we're going to be talking about is called cortisol, which is secreted by the adrenal glands. It is that hormone that gets the body ready for fight or flight. How many of you have ever been in a situation where you're in a strange place, maybe in the woods, maybe in a strange neighborhood, and suddenly you're all alert? Maybe you feel a coolness in the back of your neck. Maybe you can feel the hairs on your arms are standing up straight. That is cortisol in your blood. And what it's doing is getting your body ready to either fight or boogie. So, 2 hormones, cortisol and testosterone. Now, these are secreted and managed by the brain. Basic biology. The brain is nothing more than a muscle. And you have many muscles in your body. And you're connected to the brain by many neurons and running back and forth. So the brain feedback loops run in many directions. It's not just the brain is giving orders, but it's also the other side. Your muscles can give orders to the brain. It goes back and forth. There's an excellent and classic TED talk by Dr. Amy Cuddy of Harvard University, who's done some scientific experiments on testosterone and cortisol. And I would definitely suggest you watch this if you like what I'm going to be saying. You can find her just by going Amy Cuddy TED. Now, here is a team that just won. Look at their faces. Their mouths are wide open. Their eyes, in some cases, are there. And their arms are extended. This is the typical victory pose. Here's another typical victory pose. Again, notice somebody, one, the person on the right, she is making her body bigger in space by extending her arms. Somebody lost, that's the person on the left. She's making her body smaller by putting her right arm closer to her body. Notice the legs. The person on the right has expanded her legs to make her space bigger in the world. The person on the left, not so. Here's Tiger Woods. Again, typical classic winning pose. He makes his arms stretched, and he's making himself bigger in the world. Same again. This Sunday in a football game, you'll see it again. When somebody gets a scores, they're going to look just like this person. This is your typical victory pose. Now, here's the interesting part. In Massachusetts, we have something called the Special Olympics. And many of the people that are running the Special Olympics are blind. They have never seen anything. And here's a photo of somebody crossing the finish line. And they could feel the tape breaking on their chest, so they know they won. What do they instinctively do? The victory pose. Arms outstretched, making their bodies big in space. People have never seen anything do this when they are victorious. Now, Amy Cuddy is saying that since the brain not only gives information to the muscles, but accepts information from the muscles, by making this victory pose, you send a signal to your brain to increase the level of testosterone. And that's exactly what happened. She has a lab at Harvard University. She'd have students come and spit in a test tube, and she does a baseline measure of testosterone, has them do a victory pose for 2 minutes, and then after 2 minutes, spit into the next test tube, and she looks at the sample of testosterone, and it is increased just in 2 minutes. Here's an alternative. Here's someone trying to make her body smaller in space. Here's someone trying to make her body smaller in space. Here's someone in a classic defensive posture, trying to protect every part of himself. Now, Amy Cuddy would have students come in, have them spit in a test tube, take a baseline measure of their cortisol, then have them sit like this for 2 minutes, go in a spit again, and take a second reading, and guess what? Cortisol level is up. The goal of the calm, assertive leader is to have higher level of testosterone in your blood, lower level of cortisol in your blood. Here's a very concrete example of how I have used this in my own business. I'm a sales guy, that's what I do. And like any good, conscientious sales guy, if I have an appointment, I'm going to show up 20 minutes before the scheduled appointment. Now, what am I going to be doing? I'm going to be sitting in my car waiting for the right moment to walk in the office. Well, being conscientious, what am I going to do with that extra 20 minutes? Oh, I'm going to go on to my mobile device and check my email. But think about yourself in a car checking your mobile device for emails. You're actually making yourself small. Your feet and your arms are close together, sort of like this guy. So what I did was, I said, wait a second, what I'm doing is I'm decreasing testosterone, I'm increasing cortisol just by being in the car. This is not a good idea. So I went into the company, went up to the president's office, asked the assistant if I could use the men's room. Thankfully, it was empty. I went into the stall, and I did this. I did this for about a minute. Came out of the stall, nobody saw me, went to the president's office. We talked about coaching. He asked me what my price was. I gave him a price 15% higher than what I was planning to say to him, and I got two assignments out of it. Now, is that cause and effect? The answer is I don't know. All I know is I think going to the bathroom stall and doing this for 1 minute or 2 minutes is better than sitting in my car checking my emails. Think about this if you're a candidate for a job. What are you going to do right before the job interview? Go to the bathroom, go to the stall, and do that. Again, we are talking about the dynamics of the body and how the muscles send a message to the brain. And by doing sitting like this, you're communicating to the brain that you're in a defensive mode, send the cortisol through the blood. Implications. You want to be sensitive to postures that stimulate cortisol. You want to engage in postures that stimulate testosterone. Most of those postures, those victory postures, you have to do in private. So the bathroom stall is the best place for that. If you're doing going to an important meeting, make it as part of your checklist. Just go to the bathroom stall and do a victory posture 2 minutes before the meeting. What you're doing is you're manipulating your brain to increase testosterone in your blood. Why do you want to do this? Because you want to be the calm, assertive leader. So, now let's summarize what we have been discussing in this program. We've talked about the origins of calm, assertive leadership, the TV show with the dog whisperer, and I'm finding that people are no different. They want to have calm, assertive leaders. How do you become a calm, assertive leader? One is look at the biology of calm, assertive leadership and begin by being very sensitive to your body posture and your posing. And be aware that you can manipulate the amount of testosterone in your body by using the bathroom stall technique. The second is the calm, assertive scripts that you can use and you can teach your team to use for calm to create the image of being a calm, assertive leader. I'm not saying I can make you a calm, assertive leader. What I'm saying is we can teach you to act like a calm, assertive leader. And after you act like one and get positive feedback that it's working for you, you will become one and it will become natural to you. Again, I'm a big user of scripts because you can institutionalize it. And as you scale your business, you have consistency. I want to teach you how to fake leadership until you become the calm, assertive leader. So, that's it. You want to use opportunities to use non-chemical opportunities to create stimulate testosterone. And be sensitive to body postures that will increase cortisol. Remember, when you're in a car or in an airplane, your cortisol is going to increase, your testosterone is going to decrease. So at this point, this might be a good time to stop and ask for questions.
Larry, thank you so much. As we wait for some of these additional questions to roll in, I'm going to go ahead and get started with the posture topic. So can you talk a little bit more about how might one consider their posture when sitting in meetings, whether that's an interview, whether it is with a team meeting, meeting with potential clients? How might one best sit or hold themselves in a meeting to convey that they're open to new ideas, that they're confident, that they're calm? and or any postures to avoid?
What I'm trying to do is to create situations where you are in as much control as you possibly can, which was why I was suggesting going into the bathroom stall and using victory postures to stimulate testosterone. Once you're actually in a meeting itself, it's very awkward for you to be also thinking about your body posture. In a meeting itself, it actually adds more stress to be thinking, how am I sitting? Oh my God, my legs are too much together. I need to spread them up. And it's just putting more stress on you. So I would say in an actual meeting itself, it just, don't worry about it. Just do what you can. Every once in a while, however, you may want to stand up. One of the things that I do when I'm in meetings is, if it's a nice day, I will take somebody out and we'll go for a walk in the nearby parking lot or in the woods. So that gets me out of being in a cramped body position where I'm just in a defensive position. And I find just having a meeting while we're walking around, it just is breaks the chain. But basically, the technique I'm talking about is best done before the meeting, not during the meeting.
And Larry, do you have any advice for those individuals who might have a manager or a supervisor who does not exude calm in the office? So if you have a manager who exhibits a lot of stress, what are some ways to deal with that if it becomes contagious and is something that affects the office environment?
Well, I think you said you or the whoever gave the question is absolutely, positively, definitively correct. Emotions are contagious. And when someone is under stress or when someone is very angry, that is contagious and it infects other people. Now, if you're the subordinate and your boss is like that, again, a lot of this depends on how open is your boss to learning about the implications of his or her behavior on you. If the person is open, well, fine, then you can have a conversation. But most people who are under a lot of stress are not necessarily going to be that open. And so it's going to be a problem. I can help you manage yourself better. If your company hires me to manage your boss, fine, I can help that. But I can't help you better manage your boss.
Larry, we do have another question, and this has to do with email communications. You had talked quite a bit about paraphrasing. Does this technique work if you do the largest amount of your communications via email?
We are talking about how to be the calm, assertive leader. And email communications is a really good tool for communicating just facts or confirming dates. If your goal, however, is to convince someone or motivate someone, email is one of the worst forms of communication that you can find. It is just not effective. And if you want to motivate somebody, if you want to convince someone, stay off email, get on the phone and actually speak to the person so that there's a conversation going on. And you can listen not only to the words, but also the tone. One of the problems with email is that you're only dealing with the words and you're not getting the emotionality behind the words. And everybody's had that experience where they think somebody's more angry than they really are. Or somebody failed to convey their sense of emotion because they used email. So my answer to that is the best way to use email is to use email for what it's really good for and don't use email for what it's bad for.
Larry, thank you so much. We do have another question that has come in. At the beginning of the presentation, you cited several examples of male leaders. Do you have any thoughts on special approaches or considerations that women ought to consider for roles of leadership without risking being perceived as too bossy?
That's a great question. I think the scripting that I've been advocating, and again, if you go back to what I said, was one is to use probability statements to indicate your degree of confidence. The second is to use paraphrasing techniques. I think either of those techniques would work whether you are a man or a woman. That's my comment on that. I do think, obviously, and there are some issues that women have to deal with in terms of balancing not being seen as too bossy versus not being seen as too mousy, that men don't have to deal with. And how do you be less calm and more assertive without coming across as too bossy? That's a unique issue that women do have to face.
Larry, we have another question that has come in about dealing with someone else who is not being calm or assertive, and specifically in a client situation. As a potential client, you have a salesman that's come into the office, and every answer to their question is yes, we can do that. Which then leads one to believe that, you know, they're not very credible. What would be a calm, assertive response as a way to interject?
So the questioner is the client, and it's the professional service provider that's saying yes, we can do everything.
Yes, right? Correct.
I go back to an exercise that I asked you to do. And the exercise was, on a scale of 0 to 10, with 10 being one extreme and 0 being the other extreme, where are you? And if you're the client trying to talk to a service provider, and you're trying to say to the service provider, I don't have much confidence in you. One of the ways you can do that is, again, to use the scale technique. And it might be something like this. Let me react to what I hear you say. On a scale of 0, which is, I don't believe you, to 10, which is, I totally accept everything you say, I'm a 4. The value of using a scale technique is because it gets you out of the binary box. The binary box is yes or no. I believe you or I don't believe you. And in most situations, it's never either or. It's usually a scaling situation. So being clear about the scale helps the conversation get going.
Okay, Larry, thank you. And just to clarify on this question, or perhaps to position it in a different way, if you were in a sales situation, And you are working with a partner on building a potential client, and your partner is the yes man, and you are trying to temper this without overriding your partner. What is the most seamless way to get that done?
I think if this is the first time you've ever worked with this individual, there's not much you can do. If, on the other hand, you've worked with this person before, and this person has a tendency to oversell and overpromise, and you're uncomfortable with it, you can just talk about it. Again, you can use a scaling technique in terms of, I think you're style in terms of effectiveness for these kinds of clients on a scale of 0 to 10, with 0 being totally ineffective, 10 being totally effective, I give it a 3. And I want you to get to a 6 or 7. And here's some, and paraphrasing maybe one technique to do. One is, I'd never want to hear you say, 100% guarantee success. We can absolutely do that. I just think you're frightening off clients. You have to have a relationship where you could say something like that. Another thing that you could do, if you know this person well and there's some level of trust, is to have a secret signal between the two of you, that when you give that secret signal, what you're telling the other person is, shut up and let me take over. Let me give you an example. One of my clients was a political figure and very, very proud, but he had a tendency to go off on tangents, and the press knew he would go off on tangents. And so the press would ask questions that were off tangent. He would answer the questions and then answer and answer and answer, and all of a sudden he'd be out on some sort of limb answering a question he shouldn't have answered in the first place, and the headline would be about that. And he had someone he trusted in the front row. And every time she stroked her throat, which was their secret signal, that was her signal to him, shut up. Stop talking, go back, stop talking. And so he, when he saw that secret signal, he would say, I think I've said enough about this, and then let's move on. You have to have a level of trust and confidence in somebody to do that, but it allows you to convey something to somebody while preserving their dignity in a public setting.
Larry, thank you so much. And I also want to thank all of our Hoyas who have joined us on the call today. Larry, the presentation was fantastic and the content fascinating. And I encourage everyone to seek out that YouTube video featuring Amy Cuddy and the research that she does with Harvard. And I also have sent out through the chat area a link to our YouTube channel where we have our archived webinars for you. You can find more of Larry's presentations. This presentation, as I mentioned earlier, will be up in the next few days, and we will follow up with an email to you, including that link and a brief survey. Larry, thank you again from all of the Georgetown alumni, and Hoya Saxa to everyone on the call from DC. We hope to see you again.
My pleasure. Thank you so much. Take care.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.